So I'm going to talk about network virtualization and application delivery using software-defined networking. By the way, my talk is all public, fully public, and it is available right now. So at this URL, you can download it now or later. Basically, this URL is on every slide, so you don't have to be in a hurry. So today we are going to talk about four things. Five reasons for virtualizations, five networking virtualization technologies, five improvements that are innovations that are caused by SDN, and then talk about our own research. And so, first of all, Ishita had mentioned, I think, that said, is your life going to be virtualized? It's already virtualized. We have nothing physical left. We don't go to workplace physically. We don't go to shopping physically. We don't take education nowadays. We do all education. Like this one, you can do it virtually. Entertainment is all virtual. And computing is virtual too, right? So in this virtual world, basically, I don't have to tell you more as to why we have to virtualize. But just to be sure about networking, I'm going to tell you five reasons. First of all, when you have something very big, which you cannot use, or you cannot justify to use alone, then you share it. And examples are clouds, supercomputers, and now any computer today, because they're all too powerful for a single use. Second is isolation. We want to share, but then we want to protect ourselves from other people. It started with VLANs, remember? And now this is required in any virtualization technology. Whenever you share, you need some isolation. Aggregation. When you have something which is too small and you need big. All right? And so you might have a small switch, you might have a small disk, you might have a small something and you want to make a big disk. How do you do it? Virtualize it. Dynamics. When something is moving too fast and you can't keep track of it where it is, how do you do it? Virtualize it. And that is very common today. Basically, with the VMs moving everywhere in the data center, we can't keep track of them and we have to virtualize the network. Keep track of them, right? And then ease of management. If it is difficult to manage, virtualize is easy to manage. Remember the entertainment and everything else. So easy with virtualization, it's so difficult in the physical world. All right? And so for all these reasons, we have virtualization. And virtualization is basically started with my own PhD. Actually, I did my PhD, by the way, in 1978. Now, look, many of you were not born then. But basically, my PhD was in memory management, virtual memory. That was the hot topic of the time, how to do paging systems, right? And so virtual memory was there. Then it became L1, L2, L3, so many levels of virtual memory, virtual CDs, then virtual computing. It started with thin clients and now the cloud. The thing is about networking. This whole virtualization, much of the virtualization is feasible simply because of networking. Can you think of anything that we talked about in the virtual life can be done without the internet? Not really. So what about the thing is that while networking is the key to all this virtualization, people don't talk about virtual networking because it is plumbing. Without plumbing, there is no building, no beauty in any building. Can you live in a building without plumbing? No. But that is what nobody talks about. When you go to a nice building, they show, look at this building. They don't show you the plumbing, which works behind it, right? And that's what we are, plumbers. And so with that, I'm going to talk about virtual networking, because none of this is possible without virtual networking. Yes, there was virtual technology before. We have heard of virtual LANs. Actually, virtual networking started with virtual channels when the telephone company wanted to share a channel, X25, remember? In X25, when you wanted to share a channel, you got a VC, virtual channel. Now we have virtual LANs and virtual private networks, but that is not what I'm going to talk about here. We are going to talk about what is the latest in VC, in virtual networking. And this is going to be simply a tip of the iceberg. So let's look at the network today. The networks start with a network interface card connected to a computer. Then that network is connected by a bridge to another network. We call it a L2 network, layer 2 network, right? Then we connect it with a router to other L2 networks, we call it L3 network. And then we have a whole data center, we connect many data centers, and so on and so forth. Each of these has to be virtualized. None of this can be physical. So first we start with you have to virtualize the NIC, you have to virtualize the bridge, you have to virtualize the L2 network, you have to virtualize the router, you have to virtualize the L3 network, you have to virtualize the data center and everything. So there's a lot to talk about. I'm going to talk about 5 things, as I said, and very briefly actually, because I do want to get onto SDN. So we'll talk about virtualization, what is happening in the host interfaces, L2 bridges, L2 networks, data centers, and then finally on the global internet. So what is happening is now we don't have a real CPUs, we have virtual machines, and each virtual machine needs a network interface card. We have one network interface card, and therefore it has to be virtualized into many. And that is the first problem. And that is the first opportunity to make money, and that is the first place where there's a lot of competition going on with every industry trying to say our solution is the best. All right? Now here's the notation. Everything that is dotted is virtual, everything that is solid line here is physical, and I've also used the word P for physical and V for virtual. And so you see that these are virtual NICs, and there's a physical NIC, and so what are the solutions that are being worked on? Well, the people who make the virtual machines, the hypervisors, they say their solution is to put something in their hypervisor that will provide you the virtual NIC. So that's one solution. The second solution is the people who make the NIC. They say, don't go to VM people. We can provide you the solution. So the people who make the network interface card, they have their own solution. Oh, actually the people who make the network interface chips actually, Intel, they have their own solution where they use PCI bus magic to provide you virtual NICs. And they said this is better because then you are not using your CPU cycles, your software, and so on and so forth. Then there are people who make the switches like Cisco and Huawei. And you know, you can name lots of companies in this valley. They said, no. All this is not good enough. You know why? Because nowadays the networks are very complicated and the switches provide, you know, all these facilities that you cannot get from these virtual NICs, so we provide the virtual NICs. So there is a third solution, and that is called 802.1 QBG, QBH, and so on and so forth. You can read all about this from the keywords, you know, Google is there, right? But as you can see, just for the NIC alone, there is a competition. Moving on to the bridge. Now the bridges are not big enough because now the data centers have become very big, and so basically there is a activity going on there which is called 802.1BR, where lots of bridges look like one bridge. So when you manage it like a one bridge, and management becomes easy. More interesting issue is virtual machines. Again, back to virtual machines. When you have a virtual machine, there is another problem, and the problem is that not only these are VNICs, these machines need VNICs, they need a totally separate network. You cannot put one company's virtual machine on the same, actually you can put one company's virtual machine on the same physical machine as the other company competitor, but you cannot put them on the same network, because otherwise they will be able to see the messages, right? So you have to really provide what we call separation. And so again there is a competition, and Cisco has a solution called VXLAN, and there is a solution from the IETF. Actually there is a whole group in IETF called NVO3, Network Virtualization over L3, and their VXLAN is one proposal, NVGRE is another proposal, and STT, stateless tunneling transport from Nisara, is another proposal. So there are lots of people competing to get their solution in for how to do this, how to keep virtual machines on the separate net. Fourth is data center. Now your data center is one building, but it may not be big enough for yourself. So you have multiple data centers and you want them to look like one data center. One data center means one layer 2 network, one Ethernet. Because if you put them on IP, then you cannot move machines very easily. IP is not very mobile, Ethernet is. And this I can give a lecture, whole lecture on just that alone as to why that is. But in the days of the Ethernet, we selected the addresses to be absolute, and actually they were IDs, so they don't change when you move. But in the days of IP, they selected it to be addresses, such that every time you move from room to room, your address changes. So IP is not very mobile. And now, you know, this is a controversial statement, but that's a fact of life, is that it is difficult to move on IP, it's very easy to move on Ethernet. And as a result, you want this whole thing to look like one Ethernet, and so there is a standard for that from IETF called TRIL. Now, all of that is, then I want to take you to the whole global internet. And I just want to start with two events that change our life. There are lots of events which change our life. I'm starting from the networking world. Actually, I was talking to my friend Jignesh here, that my life changed when Netscape became public. Because I was working for digital, but when Netscape became public, suddenly every university was looking for a networking professor. And I got a job offer without applying, right? So same thing is happening now, is that there are two events which changed our life for many of us, even though you didn't work for those companies, are that one day Amazon, actually this is a story you need to hear, that one day Amazon president was visiting the data center and said, so many computers, what do we do with this? Are we using it all the time? They said, no, we use it 10% of the time. I said, well, what do you do for the 90% of the time? They just stay there in case we need them 10% of the time. And so he said, why don't we rent them out? So he started a computer rental business, and we call it cloud computing today. All right? It was not invented by universities. It was not invented by anybody else who is in the cloud business today. It was invented simply because they wanted to rent out excess capacity, and they had done this in other fields, like they had rented out their shipping, they rented out their other things, you know, services, right? And it was not done by IBM or Microsoft or any of the leading companies, or even Google for that matter. So cloud computing was invented, and it was possible at this time because of several things which were not there before. It was the networking speed, the virtual machines, and so on and so forth. And rest is history anyway. And second thing is mobility. Mobile computing, mobile networking had been around, but the life changed in 2007, June 29, 2007, when Apple announced iPhone. There were lots of mobile phones. I have had a smartphone even before that, but they were not really smart by today's standard. Right? Today we know what a smartphone looks like. And that has changed the world too, because now we have to worry about mobility a lot more than we did before. And so now the carriers and the vendors, everybody has a challenge as to how to do this thing. And the problem is because now everything has become global suddenly. If you're Bank of America, you need a web app, you need an iPhone app that covers the whole world. If you write a simple game like Kill the World or whatever the world game is, you have to cover the whole world. You have to cover China, you have to cover India, you have to cover USA. And so how do you do that? It's possible today. You can just get all the computing all over the world. Right? But what is not possible is networking. And this is what is happening with these services. All these services, whether it is Facebook or Google or anything else, they all started with a single server in a university. Right? When they became popular, they moved to Silicon Valley, and they hired they get a data center, they get VC money, and then they need lots of load balancers, they need SSL offloaders, application to application, and so on and so forth, and partitioning, lots of stuff like that. And then they become very popular, and then they have to move off to the clouds, and now what do you do? What is the problem? There is a problem here. problem is that inside the data center, you can do lots of application partitioning. First of all, there is no one server anymore. You have multiple servers. So you have the application, and you have to decide how to break the load, but then you have to break the application too. You send the video messages to server S1, the counting messages to server S2, you send reads to one server, writes to another server, and so on and so forth. I could go on this application partitioning. And second thing is the application is no longer end-to-end. The original internet was designed TCP so that your connection was from end-to-end. Nowadays, when you connect to Google or connect to any service, it is not end-to-end. If you connect to some device, that device connects to some other device, that connects to some other device. So you have multi-segment connection. And as a result, this data center, which inside the data center you have so much complexity, how do you replicate this when you have multiple clouds? And that's where the problem, that we are working on. So the idea is you have multiple clouds that belong to different companies. So the thing is, first of all, if you just go with Google or with any one company, then they will probably take care of your problem. But if you go with multiple companies, then you have a problem, because how do you move your writes here and reads there and things like that? And the problem is that that network that is connecting all these clouds is connected by the ISPs, the carriers. And the carriers have no idea of any of this. All right? They don't know anything how to run a data center that much right now. I mean, actually, they probably know because they're running their own data centers, but they're not providing the same services to the customers to run their data centers when they're not in a building. All right? And yes, it is possible to statically route your messages by playing with DNS, but that is very static, too static for the VMs today. Our VMs move too fast. Google has a problem like this, and any company which is big enough to be worldwide has a problem like this, and they have solved. Google has solved this problem by putting their own network. They totally bypass the ISP. They have a Google WAN, and what they do is they go to the ISP and put their little box there, Google box. And so the Google is very happy because they get their traffic right away. And the ISP is very happy because 90% of the traffic is already taken care of by Google. Right? So both are happy, and you are happy too because you get your instant search. Before you can think what you're searching, they will tell you what you're searching. Right? And so everybody is happy. But the problem is with this solution is that only Google can do this. They have Google dollars, we don't. Right? So we need to have a solution that will make the rest of us happy, and that means any ISP can offer this service. ISP can put a box which will take the traffic for you. You are, you know, simple company like Bank of America or something like that, and then your traffic will go to the right data center, right place, reads and writes will go as you want it. So that's the thing that we are working on, OpenADN. Application delivery, open application delivery, and basically, we are not changing the rest of the world, we are just changing these red devices so that we know that basically one of the things that is that we don't believe in clean slate. So basically the rest of the internet will remain the same, and if this is implemented, then ISP can offer this service. Now this one is actually based upon SDN and OpenFlow and so on and so forth, and there are lots of other things that we have used. There's a paper that you can read, I'm not going to talk about those things, but SDN is one of the keys that made us think about this. So I'm going to talk about SDN. Now SDN, how many people know SDN? Okay, all right. Now, so SDN actually, we have been working on for 2 years. So I mean, we thought everybody knows about it. And so the idea is that there are five things which can define SDN, in my view. First is separation of control and data plane. Second is flow-based control. Third is centralization. Fourth is programmability. And fifth is standardization. Now these five I will cover one by one. So one first thing that SDN is defined by is that we want to separate the control and the data plane in the network. What is control and what is data? See, when data is what you send on the network. What the users send on the network, that is data. But to send that data, we need to do something more. For example, we need to prepare a routing table. So that control part is something that we need to separate out. Right now in the internet, both are together. So the same routers send the messages to the next router saying that I'm a router and I have a connection to this other router, and they figure out how to send it, right? And that's a problem. Problem is that, you know, one computer in Pakistan said, I have connected to YouTube, direct connection to YouTube, all YouTube traffic went to Pakistan. This is the true fact. All right? So the control needs to be separated from data, because anybody can send that message. So Stanford people came up with this idea that this should separate the control from the data. And there is another advantage of that. The advantage is that basically if in the switch, there is a lot of, in each switch and each router, there is a lot of circuitry, a lot of code just for the control part. If we take that out, the rest is very simple. And rest is mostly hardware anyway. So basically they divide into two parts. One is forwarding element, which all it does is it uses the forwarding table. All the rest of the work is done by the central computer, which does the preparation of the routing table. All right? And the thing is, the control plane is kind of complex. You need really big computer. And while the forwarding is very simple, and it has to be done very fast. It has to be done billion times a second, whereas control doesn't have to be done billion times a second. So it's good to keep them apart. And so they said, why don't you just have one expensive controller and have lots of cheap workers, you know, cheap labor. And that works in the real world, doesn't it? All right, so it works in the networking. Second idea they came up with is that all this control should be flow-based. And the problem is that today the disk, the data, the memory sizes have gone up by the Moore's law, but the packet sizes have not. I was involved in the Ethernet 1 design, we set the packet size to 15-18 bytes, it has remained the same. It has not changed. And so what we have, we don't have packets anymore, we want to send the train of packets. Whenever you want to send anything, it's a train of packets, and that is called a flow. And therefore, why don't we make a decision for the whole flow? For the train, the signaling is very easy, because you tell that, okay, put it on this track, and the train, whole train goes, as opposed to cars, where for every car you have to decide where it goes. Right? So we don't have cars anymore on the highway, we have trains, and therefore flows. And so they said, okay, all right, we will define the flow, and it's very easy to define. We look at the header, we look at the port numbers and so on and so forth, layer 4 switching we call it, and we just, for each layer 4 flow, we have a rule that says, drop this packet, throw this away, do this, that, whatever you want to do. Very easy, flow based. Third thing they said was centralization of control. That the control should be centralized and not distributed. When the original internet was designed in 1967, the problem was that America was afraid of Russia, and they were afraid that if Russia was to bomb AT&T headquarters, the whole United States will be gone, because we won't be able to talk to each other. Communication problem, right? Central point of failure. So they said to this team that please design a network where everything can be bombed, but not everything will work still. And so we designed the internet. And you can break out the N-2 computers, N-2 routers, but two routers will still be working. And they will still be finding the routes, right? So we came up with a totally distributed system. Now, 40 years later, two generations later, the thinking has changed. 20 years is the generation, right? Two generations later, we think that centralization is bad. Why? Now, I will tell you that. Before that, you have to really think about it, why centralization is bad. Now, the thing is, every company that you are, for example, Huawei here itself, or any other company that you work for, you are not distributed. You don't have the same power as your boss, because if you did, the company will not run. Right? So why not networking? And the idea is follows that if suppose you get sick, who do you call? You call your boss and say, look, I'm sick today, I'm not coming, and I'm done. If you were distributed, you will have to call 20 other colleagues and say, look, I'm sick today, and today I will not be able to join you on the virtual meeting. That is too much work. And that's what now routers do today. They have to tell every neighbor that I'm down. And then the neighbor has to tell every other neighbor that he's down. And then they have to tell their neighbor that he's down. And by the time everybody knows that you are down, you are probably up again. right? It's too slow. For control, it is much better to do centralized. All right? You tell the boss, and the boss tells everybody. If everybody needs to, they will ask you. They ask the boss, there is a Raj Jain today, and he will know that, okay, he is in California. Much faster. And I can go on and on and on. Centralization is good. Now you buy it, right? Okay. So now you move on to the programmability. Fourth thing is that because it is centralized, if you want to change anything, we have to just change right there in one place. Right? And after all, it is a computer, we can program it. We can tell it that please, whenever you get a traffic from A going to B, don't go this route, go through the top route, go this, do that, drop it, whatever. So the whole network can be changed like this, very fast. Fifth is, now we break down into pieces that anybody can design. So we can have this cheap hardware we already talked about, the forwarding hardware, but the software is divided in at least into two pieces, just like in the computer. One part is operating system, and the second part is the applications. Operating system is designed by a company like Microsoft or, you know, Huawei or, you know, Cisco or whatever, and the applications are designed by people who are using the network. And so we need clear APIs, application programming interfaces. Once we have that, then anybody can design the hardware, anybody can design the operating system, anybody can design the applications. And there will be lots of applications writers, there will be lots of operating system designers, and there will be lots of cheap things available because everybody will compete for the prices, and you could buy the operating system from one company, buy the hardware from another company, buy the application from the third company. That's what is happening in the computing today, but not in the networking today. All right? So these are the five things that define SDN. So we need the API. The first API that has been defined is the southbound API, the between the hardware and the operating system. And that is called OpenFlow. But that is not the only API. There's an API from Cisco. There's an API, I don't know if there's an API from Huawei, but every company has their own API. Someday there will be one, we don't know when, but right now there's uncertainty. Then the northbound API has not been defined yet. All right? And there are lots of operating systems that are being written. But the things are not as clear as one would think, because it is not really clear where the boundary of the hardware and the software is. OpenFlow is being changed by the year. You have version 1, version 1.1, version 1.2, version 1.3, and they are not compatible. If you have a version 1.1 hardware, it will not run with version 1.3 software. Right? So if you buy the hardware, you will find that this is not as programmable as you had thought before. So the things are still moving slowly. I mean, not moving really slowly, they're moving fast, but they are not settled yet. However, this has caused a big impact. It's a tsunami. And I have seen these tsunamis before. Today, if you're doing anything, it has to be SDN. Not only networking, if you're doing anything, not only in this area, but also in anything, you know, everybody wants to call software defined. And the reason is because the hardware has become so fast. Today's CPUs coming from Intel are so fast, with so many processors, that you don't need any special hardware for anything. So everything can be software defined. Right? Previously we would have called them software routers, we call them today software defined router, because software defined has become a sexy word. Right? That's the best thing to do. So there are software defined bases, what you call the tower, software defined base station, software defined router, software defined everything. All right? And so everything is software defined. If you don't know what is software defined, you know, you learn fast, because this is what is happening today. And basically, these are good times. And actually right now, everybody loves software defined, because a customer like Google, Amazon, Docomo, who buy lots of switches, they are very happy with all this. Why? Because the switches will become very cheap. If all of these things happen, as I said, the hardware becomes cheap, the software is coming from many companies, as opposed to coming from a single source. Right? So they are very happy. So this is why it is so much is happening. Now, I must say, and people will ask me, is that what is going to happen in the future? What will happen? So I have seen this many, many times, and I'm just going to repeat it here again. I have been since I said 1978. I got my PhD in 1978. So 30 years, so many tsunamis have come. The first tsunami I went through was with ATM. ATM and optical networking. Any company that did not invest in optical networking and ATM probably is not here anymore. And any company that over-invested is not here anymore either. So these are the times when you have to make the right decisions. And so basically, every technology goes through this curve. This is not my curve. This is well-known curve. Every technology goes through this research cycle, hype cycle, disillusionment, and success or failure. I put here ATM just as an example because I went through that. So the thing is, before the technology is done, everybody says, this is the future, this is where everybody should be, this will solve all my problems. In fact, every technology is, I have a wedding, basically. It's like a marriage. Before marriage, there's this person who will solve all my problems, has the right quality, the best person in the world, right? And the day after wedding, we know some of those things were not true. And we learn to live with it, right? I mean, some marriages don't survive, but most of them survive, and then we learn to live with them. Same thing happens to the technology, is that before this, this is the future, and everything is going to happen. And then some people overinvest, there's a lot of money invested, and then suddenly people find out, no, this is not everything that is going to happen. And then some technologies survive and some die. All right? So SDN is not an exception in my view. However, the good point, these are all very good things to happening, because if this thing is hype was not there, no money will be invested and we will not move forward. Nothing will move forward. It's like, you know, if you don't have marriage, the children will not happen and the whole world will stop. Right? So the thing is, you need this hype for people to work on these things. And second thing is, only who work during the hype period are the ones that really make money. If you want to work on any technology, you have to work on the period before, in this hype period. This is where the startups happen, this is where the technology differentiation happens, this is where the money is made. If you work on this period, you don't make any money, because that time it belongs to the big companies who only rely on the manufacturing, better this and that. So that's not for professors, that's not for engineers, that's not for companies. And so this period, you really have to worry about how to get there and be right still. Alright, so we have got our own future on SDN, and so we are basically open ADN. Open ADN, and so open ADN basically sits on the top of SDN stack. Right there on the top you can see open ADN. And what we do is actually this is my last slide actually in some sense, is that any application provider such as Bank of America or Facebook or anybody else, they have a controller that talks to the ISP's controller. So they say, look, if I had my own virtual internet, global internet like Google has, I would like my traffic to go from here to there, there to there, this and that, this rule, that rule, and if I want my rights to go there, video to go there, and so on and so forth, they can tell all the rules. Those controllers can talk to each other. Right? And then the ISP controller will accept some, will reject some, and whatever it accepts will implement those. Only on the edge devices we are doing, so we are not changing the internet. And so basically each ISP, each company will have their own Google WAN if this is done. Alright? So the key features. So there are five features. Now this applies to every technology actually that one needs to develop, so you might apply it just not for ADN but anything else. That we are just changing the edge devices. We don't want to change the world, and you cannot change the world. ATM wanted to change the world, they could not change the world. And so, whatever stage stays. Basically, whatever is there, people are not going to throw. And if you want to throw it away, even IPv6 couldn't throw it away, IPv4, so don't even imagine about it. Okay? Things are going to stay whichever there. However, you have to work with those things, and then you will succeed. And that's how MPLS does. MPLS works with IP, and it does the same facilities as ATM does, and therefore people love it more than anything else. Alright? So we work with the edge devices only coexistence, backward compatibility. Is that it should be totally be transparent to people what is happening. You should have the old traffic go on the new one, the new traffic go on the old one, And that is what Ethernet actually did. When you buy Ethernet today, you go and buy 10 gigabit or 1 gigabit Ethernet. Do you know what is in your house? You don't care. You just connect and it all works. Right? And same thing should happen with SDN or with whatever technology you bring it in. People should not be asked to throw away the old stuff or to, you know, do this and that. Coexistence. Incremental deployment. They should be able to buy just one of these. So you buy a gigabit Ethernet, you don't have to buy 10 of them, you just buy one. Right? Would you benefit? Maybe not, but if you put another computer that has a gigabit, you will benefit by the way. Right? So you should be able to buy small quantities, incremental deployment. IPv6 did not do that. By the way, let me tell you all of these five things IPv6 missed and is still not here. I started teaching IPv6 back in 1991 and it is 2013, we are still teaching. Right? And so, incremental deployment. Third thing is economic incentive for the first adopter. Whoever buys the first of these SDN boxes or first of the ADN boxes should benefit, and they should not wait for five other neighbors to buy it before they can do it. Okay? And so that is the thing, is that, you know, you can, anything that requires bulk purchase on the first thing, you know, will not succeed. Fifth is resource owners keep complete controls. In our technology, for example, the ASPs don't control the ISP's network. You cannot control the cloud network. But the cloud compute, cloud owner and the ISP, the network owner, controls their own network. You tell them what to do. It's the same way. Right now, when you want to send an IP packet to an AT&T network, you don't tell AT&T how to send it. They decide. You just tell them source and destination, and they take care of it, the rest. Same thing should happen when you program their network. You don't program them. You tell them how to what you want, and they will program it. All right? With those, I think if you design it, it will succeed. And that is what will happen, is basically we will get a version of SDN. We will get a version of the current TCP/IP. That will be programmable. That will be, you know, basically have the abstractions, will have the layers that you will be able to basically, you know, buy pieces from different places. Some pieces will be old pieces. You will have to buy from the old people if you want to manage them. And some people will, something will be new that you can buy from anywhere. But this will continue for a long time before the old will be replaced by new. Probably never, right? Okay. So with that, I want to come to my end. Last slide. You see three key points. First is, because of the cloud computing, but computing is all virtualized today. The storage is all virtualized today. And therefore, networking people have to provide the facilities to keep the momentum going. Right now, when you get a virtual computing from Amazon, you don't get networking, by the way. You have no control over networking. You have no control over bandwidth. You have no control over, you know, how your traffic, really what bandwidth it gets. It's just up to them. All right? So we need to virtualize it. Virtualization means you feel like it's your own. So numerous recent standards related to networking and virtualization are happening both in IEEE, IETF, Open Networking Forum, and so on. So recent architectural trends are something new which has happened in the last 3 years. 2 years ago or 3 years ago, I would not have said a word positive about centralization. Today, I'm saying that centralization is good. That's just last 2 years. Okay? Centralization of control plane is something. Standardization of the networking abstractions, basically these boundaries where the hardware ends, where the software begins, where the operating system ends, those boundaries clearly being defined is what is happening. And so now most devices will be software defined, not by SDN sense, but simply because the hardware is so fast and so general that most devices will be implemented on the standard Intel architecture, or you can name other competitors. You know, I don't mean that only Intel, but on a standard computer with software. And so OpenADN, and then we have our own research. We are working on the global virtualizing the global internet. Thank you.
Any questions for Dr. Jain?
Which one of the features out of the five that you have do you think has the biggest possibility, biggest opportunity to grow the pie bigger? Is it programmability? Is it making the network application aware? Or is it the other way around? Just trying to understand what's your view.
Thank you. Yeah, I think the question is, out of these five, which one will make the money first or faster or whatever, something like that, right? Now here's the thing, this is just on the spot, right? I think programmability is the top one. If, and this is where the industry is struggling right now, I read some news article that, you know, we could do all this with SNMP. Right, you could program your device with SNMP. Yes, so if you can do that, at least, see right now SNMP, I mean, I can go into that direction, but the thing is not standard, and every device needs its own, what they call MIB and so on and so forth. There are so many other things. So I think out of these five, programmability is probably the key, and that will help all the old devices. So this is what is happening, is a lot of vendors, including Cisco and Huawei and everybody else, they are working on making their device programmable now. Even their old devices. So whatever they had their own pocket for changing the device, now they are giving it to the customers, saying that please, no, you use this rather than going for SDN. So that is the top thing, I think, among those five. Yeah.
All right, that's a good question. So this is more regarding OpenFlow.
Yeah.
So we have this entire industry trying to, you know, move towards OpenFlow and SDN, yeah. And yet at the same time, Martin Sparrow, the Nicira founder, he created quite a splash in late January when he wrote a blog and said that he was all wrong about it. He set up a very intelligent controller with dumb hardware forwarding.
Yeah.
He was wrong all along. He made $1 billion.
I know.
He now says that
I know.
This,
okay.
The right version of OpenFlow is OpenFlow controller controlling open virtual switch.
Yeah, right.
Where does the industry stand in light of these comments?
So the thing is, okay, hold on. Where is my slide? So OpenFlow, first of all, everybody should be clear of the difference between the OpenFlow here and the SDN, which is the whole picture. Right? And while SDN is the whole architecture, there is no debate about it. OpenFlow has many competitors, which we didn't show you here. Has many competitors. Even now, you know, I mean, and so on and so forth, right? Now the question is, and OpenFlow is still has, I mean, I don't want to give a talk which is negative. I mean, I could give a talk totally on, you know, what is wrong with OpenFlow. I work for university, so I don't have to teach one line, right? I mean, you know, this is one thing with freedom of speech with us, is that I could give you, tell you what is wrong, and I already told you that compatibility, backward compatibility is a big issue right now. And is there a physical boundary such as this? And so there will be, I mean, this will take 2 years before all this becomes very clear. Like, let me just show you an example of PCs. When the PCs, I was there in 1984 or something, or maybe even before that, when Microsoft started selling DOS. At that time, there were lots of other PCs. There were lots of operating systems, and Apple and IBM PCs survived, but everything else died, right? So that kind of thing is going to happen. And I am not the one that can tell you right now before that happens, by the way. Right? This is that much too complex. So yes. So the thing is, Martin Casado probably found that there is a lot more market for him, you know, upper layer than over here. And it may be, I mean, the thing is, some of the things that he has to say, actually I have high respect for him because, you know, he started all this, by the way. He is the inventor of this whole concept of OpenFlow and now SDN and so on and so forth. So I have very high respect for him, but also then he has to save his $1 billion as well. And so you have to take the words, you know, with that intent. Yeah. Yeah.
The professor, Scott Shanker, said because of the centralized stuff, then the protocol will be passed. So what's your comment on that?
So that's an extreme. Let me just tell you one more thing. I am a professor, but I really spent 20 years in the industry, including 6 years in a startup here in Silicon Valley. And I know one thing for sure, that the old world never goes away. So the Ethernet that I bought in 1980 is not gone away. I still keep it. You know, you haven't thrown away anything old. So TCP/IP will go away. That I won't see in my own lifetime. And it may go away some year, but it will change slowly. And every of those tsunamis that come, that doesn't really throw away the whole world, it just changes the world a little bit, and changes in the right direction. So yes, SDN SDN will come slowly. It may not come in the form of SDN like they think today. It will change. Like programmability, I said, I cannot imagine that the network will not be programmable, whether you are programming TCP IP, or whether programming the application, or whether programming the open flow. That is that different devices will do differently, but programmability is here to stay. Alright, that's a good idea. How come we didn't program before? Because previously this was not there. Now we can program. Now so the question is that do we throw away TCP IP? I'm not going to throw away TCP IP. So as I said, there are five features I pointed out. Those features are all good in some sense. And I think we will see in some form all of them. Right? They don't require, any of them don't require you throwing away TCP IP. So you know, I mean, think of anything else. I mean, everything that has happened, particularly the computing is different than networking in some sense. I mean, in computing, you can at least throw away the old computers. I have thrown away all my old computers, and I throw away every 2 years my old computers. But networking is very different. Mm-hmm. This networking is plumbing. It is behind the walls. It is, you know, among these things. We can't change that every day. Right? So there you go. It will change, but not the, go away. Okay.
So can you comment about the mouse-bound API ecosystem? Can you use your experience to predict, you know,
R? Oh, come on. Okay. So this is a big switch versus, you know, XY company and Z company. Every company has their own view on that one. Okay.
My question is specific to application defined network. There are several, you know, startups in the Valley.
Yeah.
Can you see, you know, who will those application defined network networking companies to, you know, put forward the new API or otherwise the
No. So this is one thing is that I believe in standards. I believe in standards. So basically, I think something standard will happen. And OpenFlow is the only standard right now in that area. But what I was saying was that since the old devices will not go away, and since the old devices do not understand OpenFlow, there will be something competing with them, at least for the old devices. For the new devices, maybe not. Does that answer your question? So there are billions of old devices. And then, you know, every year millions of new devices will come. So they will probably be open flow enabled. But programmability is going to happen for old as well as new. And so we need some other things that can program the old one, and they will be proprietary. Because the old hardware is proprietary. Okay? Thank you very much.
Thank you.